It's my pleasure to introduce Lech Naputovsky from the University of Toronto, who is now a member. And he's going to talk to us about geodesic nets.
Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me both to this seminar, to this wonderful program. So what I'm going to talk about, talk about geodesic nets. It will be kind of hodgepodge, kind of review of some older facts and some newer results. New results will be mostly by Fabian Parsh, a brilliant PhD student at the University of Toronto, as well as some other joint results with Fabian. Maybe I will start from the definition of geodesic nets or networks. In Riemannian manifolds. What they are? Maybe a right place to start will be just to mention geodesics that connect pairs of points on a Riemannian manifold. So geodesics are critical points of the Lens functional on the space of curves connecting those points, but not necessarily local minima. So similarly, given more than 2 points, 3 or more points in the plane, surface, or more generally Riemannian manifold, and some graph, we could try to connect those points by means of a graph, and we could consider all graphs connecting those points and to ask for critical points, again, not necessarily local minima, for the Lens functional in this space. So here we could think about some graph, I don't know, that connects those points, right? And formally speaking, we are talking about some one parametric flow of diffeomorphisms that, however, fixes the initial points that must be the vertices of the graph, but is allowed to move all other unnecessary vertices of the graph. So in principle, one interesting and important case when we are not connecting any set of points and we're just looking at immersions of graphs or multigraphs into Riemannian manifolds and ask for critical points of the Lens, for the Lens functional for those objects, and those objects are called closed geodesic nets. No boundary vertices. So what does this all mean? So looking at the first variation formula for the Lens functional, it's easier to state a kind of more useful combinatorial version of this definition. So a geodesic net essentially will be in a Riemannian manifold an embedded or immersed graphs, it depends on your taste, or immersed graph, or multigraph. Usually one just works with multigraphs, so let's talk with an embedded or immersed multigraph, so that each edge is a geodesic between its end points. And two, we have the following balancing condition at each balancing condition. Let me draw a picture. So here we have a vertex of this graph, V. And we have some amount of edges, some number of edges incident to this point. And we look at all unit tangent vectors directed from this vertex. So all those are unit tangent vectors to edges. Let me call those vectors w1, w2, etc. They live in the tangent space to the manifold at this point. And the balancing condition is that the sum of all those tangent vectors must be equal to the zero vector. So that's a balancing condition at a vertex. So now, if we are talking about closed geodesic nets, for closed geodesic nets, this condition must hold at all vertices. However, if we decided that we really would like to connect some collection of points by a graph that can have more vertices, we kind of divide all vertices into two classes. So here, on one hand, we have kind of initial or boundary or unbalanced. I will explain this term in a second. So their balancing condition doesn't need to hold. And then the rest of vertices, which will be called balanced vertices, will be all the rest of vertices balancing condition holds. So yes, that's an interesting question. So initially, I will allow multiplicity. However, a significant part of my talk will be about not closed geodesic nets, geodesic nets with boundary points in the Euclidean plane. So once one finds oneself in dimension two plane or more general surfaces, then of course it makes sense to consider two different cases. One case when we allow multiplicities, and I will be referring them later as geodesic multinets. And another interesting case when you allow only multiplicity one. That's a good point. Right now, assume that we allow arbitrary multiplicities. So I would like maybe, despite that it is really not the main subject of my talk, I would like to talk first a little bit about geodesic nets in closed geodesic nets on Riemannian manifolds. I will do kind of a mini review. So closed geodesic nets on Riemannian manifolds. Of course, the most basic example would be just periodic, but not interesting example, would be periodic geodesics. Or we can have several periodic geodesics, and we could kind of combine them together. Something like that. Here is one periodic geodesic, another. We could have as many those big circles whenever we want them, and their union will be a geodesic net. So there will be points of intersection, and it's easy to see that the balancing condition will hold at all points of intersection. That's a trivial and not very interesting example of a geodesic net. So if, for example, one speaking about S2 with a round metric, somewhere circa mid-1950s, Heppes classified closed geodesic nets with vertices of degree 3. With all vertices of degree 3. There are 9. Nothing interesting there. So, for example, one of kind of the easiest of them, which is has nothing to do with periodic geodesics, looks like that. Let's take two poles and connect them by three meridians, forming angles 120 with each other. So somehow geodesic nets of some of this type sometimes are called tetragraphs. Here may be a small digression before I will go any further. So returning to this balancing condition, so what exactly this balancing condition tells us? So assume, for example, that we have a vertex of degree 3. So if we look at those three unit vectors in the tangent space, so they must sum to 0. It's easy to see that they're in the same plane and that, in fact, the angles will be 120. Now, in two dimension, if we have, for example, a vertex of degree 4, it's easy to see that locally we are having just an intersection of two smooth curves. The balancing condition tells us that in dimension 2, it will be just kind of intersection of two curves. In higher dimension, it need not be so. In principle, we could have two geodesic loops with the same bisector but in the same angle, but turned a little bit relatively to each other. Okay, so this was kind of a digression. Yeah, and I never saw here the convention for the rest of our talk. I mean, it's very important convention because I'm going to talk about classification. I'm never going to consider vertices of degree 2. No balanced vertices. Vertices of degree 2. Why no balanced vertices of degree 2? Because given any geodesic net, we could at will place or remove any number of vertices of degree 2 on any edge, which makes their role in classification very easy. So our convention will be our geodesic nets never have balanced vertices of degree 2. We just kind of remove all of them and consider them as kind of edge without a geodesic. Okay, let me return to main body of my talk. So I was talking about closed geodesic nets. So there is the following existence result due to Joel Hess and Frank Morgan. They proved that for each convex two-sphere close to a round sphere, there exists a tetragraph shaped geodesic net. So it's an existence theorem. Existence of what? Naturally, since one knows that a lot about periodic geodesics, and one knows that periodic geodesics could be made parts of geodesic nets, it's very interesting to look for existence or non-existence of geodesic nets that do not contain periodic geodesics as their subsets. And that's a result of this form. And moreover, what makes it it's satisfactory is that it's a result not about one specific metric, but about whole open set of metrics in some topology, right? And this result might look kind of specific, but in fact, surprising fact is that that's the only existence result about geodesic nets not made out of periodic geodesics. There is nothing else, no other general existence results of geodesic nets not containing periodic geodesics than this. Now, if is that a graph shape closed? It's sufficiently close in C-infinity metric. So it's sufficiently close to a round sphere, and we're assuming positive curvature. I mean, it's Riemannian sphere, yes? Yes, it would take me a significant, I mean, it's not trivial. I mean, there is some clever argument. No, not fixed point. Some kind of minimization, yes. Some kind of minimization. Some kind of minimization for some kind of function. I mean, it's a clever proof. It's not something. It's not a one-liner by any means. Right. So on the other hand, one might want maybe to prove that there are no closed geodesic nets on Riemannian manifolds, at least modeled on some graphs. And indeed, this result by Heppes that I mentioned, indeed, it tells that if you are looking at the round two spheres, then definitely a lot of planar graphs are excluded. However, in dimension two, one is greatly helped by Gauss-Bonnet theorem, right? And by basic facts of the theory of planar graphs that are totally missing in high dimensions. So a surprising fact is that in high dimensions, so first of all, there are no general, by general I mean for Riemannian matrix, for general Riemannian matrix as opposed to specific Riemannian matrix. For closed geodesic nets, when they exclude periodic geodesics. On the other hand, there are no results saying that some Riemannian manifold, some closed Riemannian manifold of dimension at least 3 does not admit a closed geodesic net modeled on some graph. So no non-existence results in high dimension either. Totally open. Now, there is another fact about closed geodesic nets that originally picked up my curiosity towards these objects. It turns out that, surprisingly, there is a number of unsolved problems about periodic geodesics that somehow turn out to be solvable if one does them for closed geodesic nets. So closed geodesic nets are rare objects. So for typical analytic matrix on closed Riemannian manifold, so the set of periodic geodesics will be discrete, and so will be the set of closed geodesic nets. So, but nevertheless, it turns out that many problems about closed geodesic nets are somehow easier than their counterparts for periodic geodesics, even despite the fact that we don't have really any examples that do not boil to periodic geodesics in high dimension. So here are two results of this nature. So for a long time, I and Regina Rotman, we were trying to solve the following known open problem by Gromov about the length of periodic geodesic. It asks, is it true that the length of the shortest periodic geodesic on a closed Riemannian manifold M can be bounded just in terms of its volume? Also, we realized that one can equally ask the following problem that perhaps wasn't asked before us, is that maybe one would want to bound it in terms of the diameter of the manifold rather than the volume, the length of the shortest periodic geodesic. So in dimensions starting from 3, both problems are very widely open, other than some particular cases involving non-simply connected manifolds. So for non-simply connected manifolds, this is trivial, and this is known in some cases. For simply connected, it's totally open. However, we were able to prove that that both inequalities are true shortest closed geodesic net is at most constant times volume of the manifold, or if you wish, another constant times diameter of the manifold. Another result of this type, maybe the most recent, so recent that it's even not yet on the archive, is a theorem by Larry Guth and Evgeny Lyakhumovich. That claims that closed geodesic nets, so for almost all Riemannian matrix on a closed manifold the set of closed geodesic nets is dense, regarded as a subset of the ambient manifold. Now, observe that these theorems do not provide us any new information about existence of some closed geodesic nets that do not boil down to periodic geodesic. Why? Because here, these closed geodesic nets could, in principle, turn out to be just a periodic geodesic. Also, maybe I mentioned the last reason to be interested in closed geodesic nets. So sometimes they surprisingly turn out to be helpful for some, for proving some facts about more classical geometric objects. So for example, a very recent theorem by Regina Rotman that are not yet published is about lengths of a wide geodesic loop. So for each, so here our setting is again closed Riemannian Mn, some positive epsilon. Now in this theorem we care about wide geodesic loops. So what's a geodesic loop? It's a geodesic which is not necessarily a smooth curve at its end point, so that this angle is greater than pi minus epsilon. Epsilon could be arbitrarily small, and one would like to prove that lengths of those curves could be measurized in terms of volume or diameter, and of course epsilon. Without epsilon, one would just get this solution of this conjecture about geodesic. So the result is that minimal length of such wide geodesic loop could be measurized in terms of volume of the manifold or in terms of its diameter. And somehow closed geodesic nets appear as some part of the proof of this result. Okay, so this was end of my short survey and propaganda for studying closed geodesic nets.
So the base point is
allowed to be arbitrary. It's not fixed. So basically, I mean, it's a kind of a certain dilution of this unsolved conjecture. Now, for the most of the rest of my talk, I am going to talk about geodesic nets in Euclidean spaces and even on the plane. So I always, so after all this story, I always had some desire to understand how geodesic nets, not necessarily closed geodesic nets, even geodesic nets that connect several points on a plane or in a sphere on a flat torus might look like. Ideally, for a while, I hope maybe even for full classification of geodesic nets with some number of boundary points on the Euclidean plane, but that's of course totally hopeless. So I am going to talk about some questions and sometimes surprisingly different answers about geodesic nets with several boundary points on the plane. So again, let me remind you, you about the convention, no vertices of degree 2. So when one starts talking about, so first of all, maybe several elementary facts. So geodesic nets on the Euclidean plane. So actually, they were studied a lot in the following context. A very natural problem is given several point, try to find the shortest graph, which of course will be a tree, that connects those points. Those graphs are called Steiner trees. One knows that all balanced vertices, all new vertices of those trees have degree 3. And there is a good theory of those minimizing geodesic networks. And then people studied also locally minimizing geodesic networks as well. And but it seems that no one really studied geodesic nets as I defined them that needn't be locally minimizing. So here are some several facts. So let me recall our setting. So essentially, a geodesic net on the Euclidean plane is just an embedded graph. It's embedded graph, or we could allow multigraphs. So in particular here, it means that we allow positive integer wastes. Are allowed? Yes, it's a good question. So it makes sense to study only connected geodesic nets, because clearly, obviously, if they are not connected, we could just split them into several pieces. So let's add connected. Also, another convention, really not very important, but just so that my definitions make sense. When we have several boundary points, since they are not supposed to be balanced, we could at will connect them by edges or not. So usually we prefer not connect them by edges. So boundary points are never connected by an edges. So here is a typical example, very basic example, very well-known example is a geodesic net with three boundary points. Assume that all angles of these triangles are less than 120, then it's easy to prove, and well known since 17th century, that somewhere in between there is a point called Fermat point or Torricelli point or Fermat-Torricelli point, so that all those vertices are all visible at 120 degrees. So this will be a geodesic net, those three points will be unbalanced, this point will be balanced. It's a basic example. So for if we have four points, then we could do something like that. We could connect them having one more balanced point, or we could connect them like that, forming two new balanced vertices of degree 3, or maybe like that. Also, we could do something more complicated. For example, we could combine all those pictures into one picture. Also, we could look at those nets involving some three of those four vertices. We are going, in some situations, we are going to have four disconnected geodesic nets of some form. And we could also combine them into one picture, obtaining a rather complicated picture with a lot of vertices. There will be some points of intersections that will be new vertices of degree 4. And we are going to get a complicated picture. But all this brings us maybe to the following realization. That if we really would like to do a classification, we are not really interested in combining pictures, we are interested in finding basic pictures, irreducible pictures. Geodesic nets do not contain any proper geodesic subnets. So I wanted to tell you a couple of absolutely obvious facts about geodesic nets on Euclidean plane. So first of all, the geodesic net in a convex hull of its unbalanced points. So in particular, this means that if we have just two boundary unbalanced points, then there is only one way, one geodesic net, namely the geodesic segment connecting those two points. Two, one could find the length of the geodesic net in the Euclidean plane by the following formula, which is of course just the monotonicity formula, minus sum over the set of all unbalanced vertices of the following quantity, V times the imbalance of V. That's the dot product. What does it mean, the imbalance here? So if we have some point that is not balanced, then of course at this point the balancing condition doesn't hold. So the sum of all unit vectors directed along the edges incident to this point is not zero anymore. So at any unbalanced vector, imbalance of V is just the sum of all unit vectors directed along edges. The proof of this formula is very easy. One, of course, can deduce it from Allard-Almgren. I mean, geodesic nets are, of course, some form of one varifolds. And one could deduce it from some more general monotonicity formula by Allard and Almgren. But of course, there is an elementary proof of this formula. One just realizes that, yes, now, I need to explain another thing about this formula. So here, when we have a vertex, we are now on the Euclidean plane. So all vertices can be thought about as vectors of this plane. We could identify tangent spaces to this plane. So all imbalanced vectors also live in the same plane, and this makes sense. So in order to prove this formula, one could observe that this right-hand side really doesn't depend on where we will place the origin. It's translation invariant. And then one could try somehow to consider circles of larger and larger radii. And one looks at the intersection with the geodesic nets. And one looks how left and right-hand side changes. And one proves actually that they change in exactly the same way. When one chooses the origin in general position. So I don't want to spend any time on that. I also would like to draw yet another example of this time geodesic multinet there are multiplicities allowed that will look somewhat like that. It will contain often arbitrarily many copies of a triangle. So the only restriction in those examples for this triangle is the following. If you denote its angles by alpha, beta, gamma, we really would like to have, or maybe alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, we would like to have cosine alpha I over 2 is a rational number. So for example, one could take alpha 1 equal to alpha 2, cosine alpha 1 over 2 will be, say, 12 over 13, then sine alpha 1 over 2 will be 5 over 13. This would imply that this condition will hold also for alpha 3. So assume that we are talking about this triangle. Let's take weights, which will be 169, always 169. But then, of course, we are going to have. Yes, so what exactly? So these directions are bisectors of angles. Alpha 1 over 2, alpha 2 over 2, alpha 3 over 2. And then I could choose some weights. Let me check paper for the exact values of those weights. So here I am going to have 240, 480, here 720, and here 312, here 624, here 936. I think that you got the idea. And similarly here, 312, 624, 936. In principle, I could continue this picture. So what's the idea here? The idea here is very simple. The idea is that some rational combination of those tangent vectors is equal to zero. If rational combination is equal to zero, we are just multiplying by the common denominator, and we are going to get some geodesic net with. And here we can have as many triangles as we wish, but the weights along those segments of those bisectors will grow. The more copies we have, the larger will be the weights. And those 3 points will be our unbalanced vertices. And all the rest of the points here will be balanced vertices. So we are going to have 3 unbalanced vertices and as many balanced vertices as we wish. And those examples could be made actually any time when we have this condition, and one could construct a lot of those triangles using Pythagorean pairs. Now, why I am telling you all this and about this strange example? So a very natural question maybe would be the following. So here we have these geodesic multinets with weights, and one might ask, so assume that we really now care only about geodesic nets, all in the plane. All edges have multiplicity 1. Is it possible to have a situation when we have just 3 unbalanced vertices and an arbitrarily large number of balanced vertices inside, and all edges have degree 1? Originally, it might look that there is some kind of small perturbation of this picture that will do the job. A surprising theorem, which is quite, by the way, is quite difficult theorem by Fabian Parch, is that actually no. A geodesic net on the Euclidean plane or more generally non-positively curved curved plane can have at most can have only one balanced point, which of course will be the Fermat point, a point where all those 3 vertices are visible at 120. Okay. So maybe I will sketch some ideas of the proof of this theorem before going further, because it's really an unexpected and remarkable theorem. However, so the boundary is 3 boundary points, more generally plane, with 3 boundary points, sorry, with 3 unbalanced points. Can have at most one balanced point, which will be Fermat point in the middle. So there is no way somehow to make this example to have all edges of multiplicity 1. There is no way to perturb this example and maybe to do some other tricks so that all edges become edges of multiplicity 1. So looking at this example, one maybe might come with the idea, let's try turn those vertices into some kind of clouds of vertices. Those 169 edges will go a little bit apart. Maybe connect them in some way. So we will maybe get a geodesic net with three boundary points and as many balanced points as we want, but all edges have multiplicity 1. According to this theorem, that's impossible. Also, it provides some kind of surprising and very unexpected rigidity to this story, where one doesn't expect any. So maybe, before going further, before proving or sketching some ideas of the proof of this theorem for the plane, I am going to make several comments. So first of all, one might ask, so here I was talking about non-positively curved plane. What about positively? What about the case when positive curvature is allowed? So for positively curved, it's false. False without curvature restriction. So here is an example. Assume that we have a hemisphere. One could place boundary points at equal angular distance on the equator of the sphere. Then one could start going upwards along meridians with the same speed. The meridians will be geodesic. Now one observes that initially the angles between geodesics connecting those three points were 180. If, for example, we'll go almost all the way to the pole, the angles between geodesics will be almost 60. So somewhere here in between, the angles become equal 120. And then we connect them by three geodesics, and we are going to get three points. Now, juxtaposing this theorem and this example, one cannot help but to ask different questions. Of course, ideally, one maybe would want to classify all geodesic multinets with three boundary points on the Euclidean plane, but even that could be too difficult. But at least there are a couple of questions which might be not that difficult, but nevertheless, I don't know how to solve them. So the first question is, how common is this situation? In order to construct those examples, we needed to impose conditions of rationality for trigonometric functions of angles. So our first question, which we don't know how to answer, will be the following. So let sigma be the set of triples of vertices, of points in Euclidean, in the Euclidean plane such that there exist geodesic nets with unbalanced vertices at sigma and no other unbalanced vertices that have arbitrarily many balanced points. So is it true that sigma has measure zero in R square cube? So is this behavior kind of not generic? The second question, which also might be not that difficult, but I don't know how to start, will be the following. So assume that, so observe that in these examples, if we would like to have many balanced points, we need to have many copies of this triangle. Every time when we add a copy of this triangle, the weight of the next segment of bisectors will grow. They will grow indefinitely. So assume that we are now looking at geodesic nets. Again, geodesic multinets in Euclidean R2. Again, three boundary points. But now, instead of requiring that all edges have multiplicity 1, we require that the multiplicities of all edges are less or equal than some number n, just some kind of constant. Is it true that the number of balanced points will be bounded just in terms of n for some function? So this theorem was about geodesic nets of multiplicity 1. Geodesic net now means geodesic net with edges of multiplicity 1. Right, multi, absolutely, yes. Thank you for this correction. So in question 1, of course, we need to allow multiple edges for it to make sense. Okay, let's go further. So perhaps I will have time at least to start proving this theorem. Maybe I will finish it proof during the next hour. Let's see. So its proof, despite being elementary in the sense that it's just the most difficult thing that used there is the Gauss-Bonnet theorem, is quite tricky. It contains a couple of difficult-to-find ideas. So the first idea arises when one looks at some neighborhood of a balanced point. Now we are on the plane. So we know, we already saw examples, that when we have a balanced point of degree 3, all angles are 120. For a vertex of degree 4, we cannot say anything about the individual angles. But if we take the sum of two adjacent angles on this picture, we are going to have 180. The first observation would be that it makes sense to look not only at individual angles here, but at so-called combined angle, which is simply the sum of two adjacent angles on this picture. And an interesting case to consider is the situation when combined angle is greater than 180. Combined angle is just the sum of two adjacent angles. We have those edges incident to the balanced point. And let's take some edge, and let's go counterclockwise to the next edge, and then we go counterclockwise once again. So the angle between two edges separated by just one edge is called combined angle. So let's look at the situation when combined angle is greater than 180 and when the degree is at least 5, because we already know everything for the smaller degree. So here is the picture. So here we have two edges, A, which I will direct along x-axis, and C. And this is a combined angle that is more than 180. And those are unit vectors. You could think about them as being unit vectors. And somewhere here there is B, that is between them. And somewhere here there could be a bunch of other unit vectors. So all those unit vectors need to sum to minus B because of the balancing condition. And this angle, let me denote this angle by alpha, this gamma. And we assume that alpha plus gamma is greater than 180. So the lemma, first lemma, is that in this case, then both alpha and gamma are between 60 and 120. Sorry, let me check. Yes, both alpha and gamma are between 60 and 120. It's hard to see why this why this could be useful, but it is B, why it is non-obvious, but it is. So how does the proof of this fact go? So the proof goes like that. The proof goes like that. So here we have a bunch of vectors. And let me denote them, because all of them are of unit lengths. We denote them by is E1, which will be A, E2, which will be B. And there will be at least two more, E4, E3, and E4. Right? B, we do not consider B. We have En minus 1, where N is the degree of the vertex of those vectors. Sum of Ei will be, of course, equal to minus b, the balancing condition. And a cute geometric idea of proof of this lemma is the following. We are going first to replace Ei by the approximations, E1 tilde. What is E1 tilde? First of all, we observe that if A is directed along minus x-axis, like on the picture, there will be no vector directed along y. So all those vectors will be left of y-axis or right of y-axis. So E1 will be equal to minus 1, 0 if E1 is left of y, and 1, 0 if E2 is right of y-axis. So if we will sum those vectors, E1, of course, E1 will be equal to just A to E1. So if we will sum all those vectors, we are going to get just some vector of the form R minus L0, where R is the number of vectors looking rightwards of the vertical, and R number of vectors looking rightwards of the vertical, and L the number of vectors looking leftwards of the vertical. Now, we would like to correct this sum in order to get the right sum, sum of Ei. How do we do this geometrically? If we would like to correct E1 tilde, so given a vector, Ei tilde, if we really, so vector Ei is a unit vector. So correction Ey tilde is the same as kind of rotation of this vector along circle. In some cases, we will rotate clockwise. In some other cases, we will be rotating counterclockwise. With this observation, let's draw the following picture. Here we have R minus L0. And here we have the following staircase that consists of unit circles going both ways. Those are arcs of unit circles. And our observation will be that since we could start at this sum and start correcting those vectors one by one, it will look like we are going some way along some of those arcs. Then we are going along a similar arc, maybe inside, and maybe we are going inside, and then we are going here. But our observation that eventually, when we start at R minus L0 and correct those vectors one by one in order to end at minus B, we will end up inside this geometric figure. On the other hand, we are supposed to end at minus b. Minus b lives on the unit circle centered at the origin. How comes that we could end up here? It can happen only if r minus l is 0. So in fact, the correct picture will be like that. And then we need to end at this arc. And then we observe that the angle between minus b and y axis is at most 30 degrees. And that's what we are proving. So that's the proof of this lemma. Second lemma. Again, a kind of difficult to find lemma with very non-elementary proof. Elementary but difficult proof. So this lemma pertains to the following situation. So assume that we are looking at some path in a geodesic net on the Euclidean plane that we are investigating. And here we have some edge A, and we arrive to a vertex U, which is assumed to be balanced. And then we go along some edge B, and we arrive to some vertex W, which could be balanced or unbalanced. And then we go along some edge C, and we arrive to some vector V, which is again balanced. And then we depart along some HD. And our next assumption will be that in this triangle, there are no unbalanced points. But might be balanced. Could be a lot of balanced vertices, but no unbalanced. So that's the setting. So what we would like to measure? We would like to measure the angle between A and D. By the way, in my picture, A looks kind of downwards, D upwards. It's not necessary. A could come from this direction, and D could live in this direction. It's just an accident that they're looking like they are. I'm not going to make any assumptions other than those. Moreover, in principle, B and C could be exactly the same vectors. This triangle could be empty. That's also allowed. What we really care is about the angle between A, vectors A and D. Let me call it gamma. And we care, so we think about this vector as being positive if A and D are located like that, and being negative if translate of A turns out to be above D. So it could be both positive and negative. So the lemma is that in this section, that this angle gamma is less than 60 degrees. One thing to have in mind here, that we could find this angle as the turn angle. We could look at turn angles at all vertices, right? So what is a turn vector? So if we have a situation like that, then the turn angle will be positive. It will be this angle. So turn angles. And for example, if we have a picture like that, then this turn angle is going to be negative. It's easy to see that under some quite general assumption, at least in the plane, the angle between those two vectors will be just the sum of turn angles at U, W, and V. And that's ultimately will be the reason why do we care about the angle between those two vectors. It's in fact lemma about the sum of three turn angles rather than just about these vectors between two edges in this picture. So I am going to make now a 10-minute break, and I will finish the proof of this lemma and the theorem after the break. Okay. I'll wait for a second. Okay, so let's continue. So let me remind you what I'm proving, finishing to prove. So given a geodesic net in the plane, three boundary vertices, a priori the degrees of those vertices are unbounded. The claim is that the only possibility for a geodesic net is to have just one more balanced vertex somewhere so that all those vertices are visible at angles 120. So I stated the following lemma. So assume that somewhere I'm seeing a path in my geodesic net that consists of four edges, A, B, C, D, so that vertices U and V here are balanced. W, we don't know, balanced or unbalanced. No unbalanced vertices in this triangle, but maybe a lot of balanced vertices. And the claim is that the turning angle, sum of turning angles at these three vertices, or equivalently the angle between A and D, is at most 60. It could be negative, though. I'm not saying about anything what's happening when it's negative. So here is what is the idea of the proof. So the idea of the proof is the following. So let me draw this picture. Here is this triangle. The idea is we arrive at this balanced vertex U, and we attempt to go inside this triangle. We are not taking this edge towards W. Instead, we are going inside using the very first available edge. Then we arrive at some balanced point. There are no unbalanced points inside. Here, we are taking the first available edge after the edge that we took, unless this edge leads to W. If this edge leads to W, we are taking the second edge. So again, here this is the first edge going counterclockwise. Typically, we take the first available edge. Unless this edge leads to W, then we are taking the second available edge. And we are going like that. And we are getting some path, maybe like that, and then like that, and then like that, and then like that, and then like that. So we are getting some path. And there is an easy argument that this path cannot return back to revisit any vertex that we have visited. And then we know that one of two cases is going to happen. We are going, obviously, to exit from this triangle. We cannot exit through U or W, so we might exit through V, or maybe we could exit through the upper side of this triangle, like that. And those will be two cases to consider. I'm going to consider only one case, which will be basic case. The second case, treatment of the second case will be based on the same ideas. So it assumes that after a while, our path will exit through V. Now, we care about the turning angle along our original path. But of course, on the plane, the turning angle doesn't really depend on the choice of the path. Modulo some mild conditions that two paths behave nicely, one with respect to each other. So instead, we could calculate the turning angle instead of this path, right? And we could do something different. So let's consider the vertex X. It will be the first vertex where the turn angle is positive. Also, Y will be the last vertex before V where the turn angle is positive. It might be that Y just coincides with X. That's fine. So what needs to happen in order for this turn angle to be positive? Since usually we are just taking the first available H, in this case, if we have balanced vertex and we take just the first turn, this angle will be always less than 180. For positive turn angle, we need to have here angle more than 180. So it means that here we took the second turn. It means that both X and Y are connected with W by some edges that we didn't take. Also, we have this previous lemma about the combined angle. It's precisely the situation of the previous lemma. We know that in the situation of the previous lemma will tell us that both those angles here and here at X will be between 60 and 120. This will mean that the turn angle at this vertex X, so previous lemma, the turn angle at x will be less than 60. Similarly, the turn angle at y will be less than 60. Now we could calculate the turn angle as the turn angle along the path that goes to x. Now we take this h to w. We take this h to y. So we are going now to replace our path as follows. We go to x, then we take the h to w, then we take the h to y, and then we go out using our constructed path. Now our question will be what will be the turn angle at x and y now? Before it was positive. Now, since we took the first turn, it will be negative. But the previous lemma about the combined angle would imply that now turn angles at both x and y will be less than minus 60 degrees. Now, the turn angle at all vertices here will be negative. Here it will be minus 60 both. Here at w, the turn angle, on the other hand, is expected to be positive. In fact, here it could be as large as 180. But the total turn angle about along this path will be minus. Here at x, it will be at least minus 60. Here, this will be at most 180. Here will be at most minus 60, negative. The total sum will be at most minus 60 plus 80 minus 60 plus something negative. It will be at most 60 degrees. That was what we asserted. Now, why did we care? So now the rest of the proof is not difficult. So here we have those three unbalanced points. And we have here our geodesic net, which a priori could be pretty complicated. And we decide, so let's take, let's try to go around this net, staying always somewhat outside of this net. So let's consider a kind of, let's consider circumference of this geodesic net. We start at one unbalanced point. We are going to track it, staying always a little bit on edges of our net, but a little bit outside in the infinite connected component of the complement to this net. So we are going to get a picture where maybe some edges are kind of used twice that maybe might look something like that. Our goal now would be to prove that this picture actually looks like that. That we go from our original vertex to another vertex, to balanced vertex, backtrack here, here, and here. If we will prove that circumference look like that, our assertion will be proven. So first thing, first order of business will be to prove, will be to prove that between every two unbalanced vertices, there is at most one balanced vertex. We know that there is at least one balanced vertex because there are no edges going between unbalanced vertex. But we would like to prove that there is at most one. Here, the idea is very simple. Assume that we have two unbalanced vertices, or at least two unbalanced vertices. Then we are going to have an edge like that running between two unbalanced vertex. We could apply the previous lemma to four edges going like that here, and then here, and then here, and then maybe here. Maybe there is just one segment. We are going to apply our previous lemma to this picture. And we are going to know that the total turn angle here will be at most 60. Then we are going to apply our lemma to four edges, 1, 2, 3, 4 here. And here the turn angle will be at most 60. Now, when we have vertices like that, it's easy to see that when we have vertices inside the circumference, the turn angle will be always negative. It gets to be positive only at unbalanced vertices. And at each unbalanced vertex, the turn angle will be at most 180. Now we see that along this part we have 60. Along this part we have 60. There could be a lot of balanced vertices here with negative turn angle. And here there will be the last vertex where we could get as much as 180. So our total turn angle will be at most 60 plus 60 plus 80 plus some possibly negative stuff, 240, which will be less than 360 that we might get. When we kind of go along the circumference, the turn angle will be 360, a contradiction. So we know that this situation is impossible. So now we know that our picture actually looks like that. And then we could applying our previous lemma to three quadruples of edges, it's easy to prove actually that we need to get here 180 at all vertices, which will mean that the picture will be like this. I will spare you this elementary argument. So that's the end of the proof of this theorem by Fabian Parsh. Okay. So now we know what's going on for three vertices. Yes, well, I mean, that's a uniqueness theorem. So if we have three unbalanced vertices on the plane and we have a geodesic net, then if there is a connected geodesic net at all, then there is just one. I mean, if, for example, some of those angles will be more than 120, of course, we could connect those unbalanced vertices that we decided not to do, but there will be no geodesic nets that we wanted to consider. Let's go to four vertices. So we are moving somewhere. So let me remind you the story about four vertices. So for four vertices, we could have geodesic nets like that, and maybe like that, and maybe like that. And we could combine all of them, and we could maybe add to the picture some bits and pieces that looks like this, 120, etc. But that's not interesting. If we are talking about reducible nets, that what we are seeing are trees, and very simple trees. So is there some analog of the previous theorem that tells us that actually nothing but some very simple pictures are possible for reducible nets? Surprising answer is no. Here is another result by Fabian Parsh. So here is a construction of apparently new geodesic net on four boundary vertices. At vertices of the square with 16 balanced points. They are reducible, no proper subnets. Here is a construction. So let's draw coordinate axis. We start, this net will be symmetric with respect to rotations by pi over 2. Also axially symmetric, symmetric with respect to bisectors of quadrants. It will be a very symmetric net. We start from four points with vertices at 1, 0, minus 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, minus 1. Now, we are going, let's measure here the angle 75 degrees. We start going in both directions at 75 degrees. So we are going to get some very symmetric octagon that will look like that. It doesn't look very symmetric, but in fact it is. So maybe I have a better picture of what's going on. So here is what I am building in this orange octagon. So now this will be 75. So this angle will be 150. So there will be four angles equal to 150. There will be four other angles equal to what? Who was following me? So four angles of this octagon are 150. What will be the value of the other four angles? So the total angle will be 5 times 8 minus 2, 6 pi, right? 6 times 360 minus 4 times 150 divided by 4. Calculation shows that it's 120. So here we are getting our favorite angles 120. Okay, now we are going to do something strange.
Sorry, can you say again what's the result of Parsh that you're talking about now?
I'm trying to construct a geodesic net drawn on the picture with four unbalanced vertices at some four vertices of the square, those points here, 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 and here, and 16 balanced points inside, which is irreducible. It doesn't have any proper subnets, which shows that this result cannot be generalized in any obvious way for four vertices. So we constructed orange octagon. Now, let's take one of these yellow vertices of this orange octagon. So here we have those orange edges. Where is the orange chalk? Okay, I will draw it in red. Here are edges of octagon. And now we are going to go a little bit steeper, upwards and downwards. What does it mean a little bit steeper? So before we had 75 degrees. Now we are going to measure angle alpha equal to cosine 1 over 2 minus arc cosine 1 over 2 minus cosine of 75 degrees. If you will calculate it, it will be a little bit more than 76 degrees. So on computer-generated picture, those two edges will go exactly the same, but in fact, there is about 1 degree of difference. So this is the wide edge. We are going to go up until we intersect y-axis. And we're going symmetrically down until we intersect y-axis. And here we are going rightwards up to the intersection with x-axis, and leftwards up to the intersection with x-axis. Good. So we are going to get those wide edges. Now, let us have a look at this quadrilateral here. If we will have a look at this quadrilateral here, with one vertex at the point of intersection of wide edges, we observe that this is 120. So this angle is 240. So this angle will be a little bit less than 120. Not by much. It will be slightly than 120. And therefore, this wide angle will be a little bit less than 120. Therefore, we will be able to find a Fermat point for those three wide points, so that they all are visible at 120, which will be very, very close to this point, because the angle will be, those two angles will be extremely small. So here is green Fermat point that will be connected with, those points. And it's easy to see that this green line actually, because of symmetry, it goes along the bisector of the first quadrant. We could extend it beyond this white point to the orange point, which was the vertex of our octagon. Everything like that happens also symmetrically at four different locations. And now let's look what we have. Here we have a point of degree 3, all angles are 120. This is the point of intersection of three straight lines. It's a balanced vertex of degree 3. Here again, this angle was 120. This was the bisector, so those two angles are 120. That's a balanced point. So all points here and here are balanced. Those four are unbalanced, and they're supposed to be unbalanced. The most interesting thing happens at those yellow vertices. Let's have a look. Is this point balanced or not? Here we need to check whether or not the sum of five unit vectors is zero. The picture is symmetric, so y coordinates clearly sum to zero. So what happens with x coordinates? So these are unit vectors. Unit vector directed along x-axis give us 1. Now those two orange vectors gives us cosine 75 each, because those angles were 75. Two white vectors give us cosine of arc cosine of 1/2 minus cosine 75. Cosine and arc cosine cancel each other, so it will be minus sine, because those vectors will be directed in the opposite direction. Cosine and arc cosine cancel each other. 1 cancels with 2 times 1/2, and here minus and minus gives us plus. That will cancel this term. So it will be 0. Those will be balanced vertices of degree 5. So this example actually leads to more questions than answers. So a strange fact that that's the only non-trivial example of a geodesic net with four unbalanced vertices on the plane, which irreducible geodesic net that doesn't boil to some known primitive examples. The obvious question, are there any other examples of this kind? Also, all those examples combined together lead to the following question. The question whether or not, if we are talking about geodesic nets, no multiplicity, can one measurize the number of unbalanced points, the number of balanced points in terms of unbalanced points? Balanced points in terms of unbalanced for geodesic nets of degree one, our geodesic nets on the plane. So if one hopes for a negative answer, one can allow also bounded multiplicity less or equal than n that also must enter to the bound. So this looks similar to one question originally posed by Gromov and published in a paper by Yashar Mermarian that became kind of well known. So the question of Gromov, and I'm going to talk about the question of Gromov later, will be this question with an extra condition that all unbalanced vertices have degree one. Here we don't have this restriction that all unbalanced vertices have degree one. And in the question of Gromov, also the question about multinets. He doesn't care about weights, but all unbalanced vertices have degree one. I'm going to talk about relationship of what we are doing now, about this question, Gromov's question later. Observe, by the way, that in this theorem by Fabian and Parsh, there were no restrictions whatsoever on the degree of three unbalanced vertices. That's what makes this theorem interesting. So now I'm going to present some construction joint with Fabian Parsh. So what exactly I'm going to explain? I'm going to explain how one can construct an infinite sequence of geodesic nets in the Euclidean plane with 14 boundary vertices. And arbitrarily boundary unbalanced vertices. So here, why I prefer to call them unbalanced rather than boundary? Because some of those unbalanced vertices could be inside the picture. They're not necessarily outside on the boundary of the convex hull. So maybe a better name for them is unbalanced vertices and an unbounded number of balanced vertices. That seemingly refutes this conjecture. Only what we are doing, so here's what we are going to do. I'm going to explain a construction. We have proven that this construction works as advertised. So it's possible to carry this construction out. What we didn't prove, it had been verified by a computer up to large number of iterations. We checked that all edges have multiplicity one. We didn't prove it. What we were able to prove that their multiplicity, even somehow it's not one, it doesn't exceed some absolute constant. So we have a kind of provable negative answer for the kind of relaxed version of this question. And very convincing but not yet proven answer for this question. So no, one cannot. Yes, that's a good question. So 7 of those 14 will be fixed. 7 will be variable. So this example strongly suggests that one cannot measurize the number of balanced vertices in terms of the number of unbalanced vertices. It doesn't provide any answer, even answer on the level of computer experiment, to the following question. So is there a configuration of, say, n0 points on the Euclidean plane so that there exist geodesic nets without multiplicities, with multiplicity 1, with unbalanced vertices at these points, and an arbitrary many, arbitrarily large number of balanced points. If yes, then how generic is this behavior? So can one have an open set of such configurations? So I expect that the answer, at least for the first for both questions, will be yes. I think that it's a common behavior, just we don't know well to construct those geodesic nets. In fact, I will not be surprised, returning to this example of Fabian-Parsch, where the set of unbalanced points was just the set of vertices of the square, I wouldn't be surprised that if there will be a whole infinite collections of examples like this, with arbitrarily many balanced points inside. I have no clue where to look for them, or if they really exist, but it wouldn't be surprised if something like that actually would happen. So it may be that the answer for this question would provide it already by vertices of the square and all sufficiently close quadruples of points. Okay, now let me return to this construction. That's the best we can do. So maybe because it involves some pictures, I would like maybe to distribute. I brought copies of some pages. Maybe you can distribute them to everyone who wants to see. So what do you see? Maybe I'll take one for myself.
Okay.
Okay, let me explain the construction. The construction, so here there are two pages. One has number 21, right? At the top left corner of four pictures on page 21, you see this picture. So this picture is formed by two sets of vertices of two regular heptagons. So you have seven points at vertices of a regular heptagon on a slightly larger circle, and then another seven points, vertices of a regular heptagon, exactly between each pair of points on the outer circle, you have a point on an inner circle of smaller radius. Now, what is the relation between the radius? We would like this inner angle here at inner vertices to be equal to 82 divided by 21 radians. So in terms of degrees for this outer angle, it will mean that it is equal to approximately 199 something, a little bit less than 120. You probably already guessed why a little bit less than 120. One would like to do some construction involving Fermat points. So what exactly we are going to do with all that? So essentially, we are going to go in steps. We are going to construct seven tuples of points. All of them will be on some circle. Some of those seven tuples will go inwards. I mean, they will be on circles of smaller radius. Sometimes the radius of circle starts to grow, but all of them will be always inside this inner circle. And the average newly constructed points, somehow radius of circles with newly constructed points will tend to zero, but very slowly. So what you see here, it will be a construction, about 100 iteration of this construction. It's still, we are not that close to the origin, despite that we are having some exponential growth at the average. And so basically the goal of construction always turn points inside into balanced points. When we will be doing that, when we will try to balance them, we will be getting a new seven points that will be unbalanced. We will make them balanced and so on. That's a general outline of the construction. Only I'm slightly cheating. If I'm going to do what I'm going to describe you, what I will get, I will not get a geodesic net with edges of multiplicity one. When I will be doing what I'm doing for this configuration, I will be getting some of the edges will acquire higher and higher integer multiplicities that seem to be not to make this any better than this example with concentric triangles that I had at the beginning. But here there is a difference. After doing that, we will be going to move those seven points. We are going to perturb them in exactly the same way. So the picture will be still symmetric with respect to rotations, invariant with respect to rotations. We will be moving them slightly, very slightly, along circles, circumscribed circles for these triangles. No, not for these triangles. We will be moving them along, yes, circumscribed circles for these triangles, right, which will not change the value of this angle. Now, I will explain why it's this strange number, 88 over 21. Basically, the idea was that we wanted to have here the angle slightly less than 120. On the other hand, it's kind of important to have here a rational angle, because during our construction, we have certain undesirable values for certain angles. It would be really bad for us if certain angles turn out to be equal to pi, and to something that's equal to 2 arc cosine of 1 over 4 by some reason. However, using Lindemann-Weierstrass theorem, we can guarantee that all those angles that we are going to get, all the trigonometric functions will be transcendental. So those angles couldn't be equal to 180 by this strange reason. Otherwise, it would be kind of rather difficult to control those angles in some kind of complicated iterative procedure. Now, what exactly we are going to do? So basically, here we will be always seeing some unbalanced points that we would like to convert into balanced. And there are the following ways what we are going to do with them. So in the situation like that, when the outer angle is smaller than 180 and inner angle is greater than 180, we just extend those edges. We do something simple. Initially, we will just extend those edges. And we are going to get new points of intersection. And then we observe that still outer angle is less than 180, inner angle greater than 180. So we could go even further. So you are seeing these first two stages on page 21. But eventually, we arrive to a situation after we will extend them even further. We are going to get a situation that will look like that. We are going to get a new point of intersection, somewhere here. So the inner angle will be now less than 180 and outer more than 180. Now, this in our construction, in unperturbed version of our construction, it will happen only in one of two situations. This new vertex that we will now need to make balanced will be either on the same radius as the outer vertex or the same radius as the inner vertex. And depending on where we find ourselves, we do one of the following. First of all, in this situation, when we find ourselves opposite to an outer vertex on the same vertex, we just connect them by an edge. These seven outer vertices will be always unbalanced. They will be unbalanced and unchanged. Then we will be doing this picture, some seven inner vertices, which will be not necessarily inner, they could kind of sometimes move outside, they will be also unbalanced, they will be variable. So we feel ourselves free to increase imbalance at all the seven vertices indefinitely, and this really helps our construction. So we are going to connect like that. This vertex will not become balanced in general. The sum of those vectors, so those angles are not 120. The sum of those angles, the sum of those unit vectors will not be zero. So here is the next simple idea. How can we turn this point into balanced one? It's easy to see that we can always issue a couple of vectors so that the sum of those four vectors will balance, providing that, right. So in this situation, there is always a way to draw a symmetric pair of vertex so that the sum of these four will be equal to this one. With a minus sign. We will call this construction winging. So we connect it like that, and we are going to do the winging. Now, what happens if, and then this point will become balanced. We don't want those edges to become equal. The condition that those two edges are not the same is that this angle alpha, I think, is not equal to 2 arc cosine of 1 over 4. And so we are going to get new points of intersection. Sometimes those new points of intersections will be on the same radius as one of the vertices of the inner heptagon. In this situation, we are going to do the following. Since we are always supposed to connect our new vertex with those vertices on the outside, we are not going to connect it with this vertex. Instead, we are going to consider this triangle. This is the vertex we are processing. And two closest unbalanced vertices on the outer circle. And we find Fermat point for this triangle. We insert these two edges and this third edge. This point will be balanced. But of course, this point will not be balanced. And we are going to do the winging. So that's the construction. There are a lot of stuff to prove even in this unbalanced situation. So for example, we need to prove that, that this construction really works. For example, we are not going to go out of the outer circle. And we need to prove that those circles actually, it's helpful to prove that that circles with these new points eventually shrink to the base point. It requires some calculations. There are rather complicated recurrent formulas for the angles. Every time we are going to have some angles. So here we trade this angle maybe for this angle. In this situation, the formula is simple. Here, formulas could be kind of more complicated. There are some recurrent formulas that require certain elementary but non-trivial calculations. Now, that's the unperturbed part of the story. In this unperturbed part of the story, we are going to have, for example, a lot of edges running along ready to this point. Also, we are going to have a lot of edges running along this kind of radius. So the second more complicated part of the story is that we are going to move those seven vertices in this initial configuration a little bit, preserving the value of this angle along circumscribed circle here. And we are going to do the same construction with a slightly perturbed version. Since we are free to perturb as little as we want, since formally speaking, we don't want to do infinitely many iterations, just finitely many. And if, for example, we would like to say 10 to the power 10 iterations, we could choose our perturbation small. If 10 to the power 100, even smaller. So because of continuity most of the formulas works. But the key matter is to check that all those radii, all those edges that they are previously directed over radii, will become distinct. In order to do that, one needs to investigate angles. And one needs to prove that the derivatives of those angles with respect to perturbations are different on different stages of interactions. That's complicated. Formulas are complicated, so we have just an asymptotic formula at infinity that relates those angles that could be used to prove that at most finitely many edges coincide, but a numerical calculation shows that actually those edges, after small perturbations, those edges never coincide. So basically, that's the end of the story about this construction, which kind of shows that it's highly likely that one can have geodesic nets with just some fixed number of boundary points and arbitrarily many balanced points inside and all edges of multiplicity one. Now, I would like to talk now about a question of Gromov.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Yes,
then if you see some of those angles turn out to be, in this story, turn out to be more than 120, and construction breaks down. 7 was a kind of minimal number where this construction works. Some of the angles that were supposed to be less than 120. So here is the question of Gromov. So the question of Gromov is the following. I will state it in an equivalent form, in which Gromov never stated it. This form seems to be kind of slightly more general. Problem. Can one measurize the number of balanced points, vertices, of a geodesic net on the Euclidean plane in terms of the number of unbalanced points and the maximal norm of the imbalanced vector over the set of unbalanced points. So in this case, we allow ourselves to use not only the number of unbalanced points, but also the length of the imbalanced vector, which seems to be a kind of totally different game. So I expect that the answer for this question is positive, even despite that it's open and not that easy. Gromov didn't state it in this form. Or actually, Mirmarian, who published this question, stated it in the form when the norm of the imbalanced vector of each vertex unbalanced vectors is just one. It looks like it's kind of much more restricted version of this question, but in fact, they're equivalent. Because if we have some vertex with some large imbalanced vector, it's easy to split it. If, for example, here we have an imbalance vector, and its norm is somewhere between, say, n and n plus 1, it's rather easy to draw here n plus 2 unit vectors, so that the sum of the unit, they could be even very short, so that the sum of the corresponding unit vectors will be equal to this vector. And it's easy to convert. If, for example, we have a geodesic net like that with unbalanced vector with large imbalance, it's easy to draw a lot of short unit vectors, like n plus 2 unit vectors, so that this vertex will become balanced. These vertices will be unbalanced of degree 1. So if the answer for this question, when all imbalances vectors have length 1, is the same as for the general question. Now, Let me now remind you the version of the monotonicity formula for the lens. It says that the lens of this geodesic net is equal to the sum over V in S of imbalance of V times V. Now we see that one could, if for example one scales so that the diameter of the geodesic net is equal to 1, the distance between maximal distance between vertices will be equal to 1. It's easy to see that one can measureize the length in terms of the imbalance vector. So in the situation of this problem, we are talking about geodesic nets of bounded lengths, or more precisely of this bounded ratio length to diameter. So one could, in principle, pose a version of this question, which might, in principle, have different answers. The positive answer will be slightly stronger. When instead of the maximal imbalance, we simply have, we know the ratio of the length of the geodesic net and diameter, as well as the number of unbalanced vertices. Also, maybe, do I have time? No, I don't have time. So maybe I'll just stop here.